Well, I'm glad you're here today because today is the culmination of a sermon series that we have been journeying through for the last 3 months on something that we have discovered to be very moving, which is liberation theology. Liberation theology has sort of really influenced this sermon series, and it somehow continues to invite us into this gospel call. This gospel call to free all people from political, social, and economic oppression. And so you probably have noticed our sermons, our liturgies, our songs have embodied these motives that derive from liberation theology. And so appropriately, we end today with yet another embedded human distortion, shall we say, a human structure that somehow heightens our awareness, somehow engages us, and engages our participation and demands that we claim, shall we say, of the whole thing. Let me make a statement. Christianity and its followers have a somber dilemma. An imagination of self that is fractured with the imagination of the divine for humanity. There is a fundamental misunderstanding, even more so, a fundamental, or maybe even intentional ignorance of God's vision for humanity. As humans, we are so familiar with our brilliance, with our magnificence, our power and ability to create with our own hands, our strength and versatility to act, think, make decisions under our own wisdom, with our own knowledge, and we rarely deny ourselves, right? We rarely check ourselves. This formation of self, which is deeply rooted, by the way, in the flagrant margin of America's history, and yet ever so present today, especially within political rhetoric, it is perhaps the greatest temptation that opposes Christian formation. Did you hear it? That's creating religiously approved and yet distorted imagination of what we want, but not who we are. So it is with today's wisdom from Mark's Gospel. For the human one didn't come to be served, but rather to serve and to give his life to liberate many people. These are the words of Jesus, a distinct teaching I submit to you, and it's the very premise of the divine vision for humanity. Do you want to know how to be human? Well, here it is. To be human really means to live for more than self. It is a mode of being that does not hold up life. It somehow extends life on others. It calls us to the virtue of humility, to a spiritual attitude of heart. That's revealed in the human one. Willie Jennings, this is another terrific liberation theologian, a professor at Yale Divinity School, and mentor, by the way, of my mentor, Susan Ra. He says it this way: a single life has been ransomed for many. Jesus is the one who offers his body to create space for communion with God, enjoying space. This is God serving. The man who serves, in profound contrast, ransoms many for one. Do you see the dilemma? Do you see what Jesus is getting at? Do you see what Willie Jennings is getting at? Jesus was crucified as a criminal, subjugated to suffering and humiliation, and still cries out to God on the cross. He is the visible sign of humility, not a self-sufficient one. But I still want to pause here for a moment. So let the wisdom land. So let not miss the power of the Holy Spirit who counsels and comforts and guides and advocates and teaches. So to not miss the wisdom this morning. Because as we enter into the final days of the presidential election that has been heated, that has created so much division, I think we need some awareness as people to understand the things in this world that drain us. One of the things that I often think of is things that drain us are these things that are inconsistent, that they just don't seem to make sense, that they're somehow puzzling, they're incongruent, and there seems to be this incongruency between God's vision for humanity and human vision for humanity. There seems to be this distinction, this difference between what God's imagination is for humanity and what human's imagination is for humanity. And when there's this incongruity, when things don't just seem to fit, when we get into such things, when we can see to greed and control and selfishness, to hyper individualism, it just seems like those kinds of things drain us. Drain the energy, the passion, the joy that is within us as humans. And so there is this call to be aware, to be awakened by this reality that is in the midst of our world. And yet, there is this constant invitation. Some of us, we call it church. It's why we gather on Sundays, because there's this perpetual invitation to come. To come with humility, to come with an open heart, to come into this space, and you are somehow invited into the rejection of these inconsistencies that just don't seem to match the God we follow. And so, church now becomes the space where you sort of shed away all of these lies and inconsistencies and untruths. And you are somehow made whole again. And you are invited into communion again with God and with others. And you're invited into a space of liberation and healing. Have you ever viewed church like that before? Because evidently, this passage, the disciples have given into the temptation of self-sufficiency. Why are they seeking positions of honor and privilege? Why are they seeking to sit to the right side and the left side of Jesus? Why did the other disciples get so angry when they heard about this? Why the necessity to control and have possession? You may not always have enough. It's not a shared life of Jesus sufficient. These are the life-draining things of individualism and self-sufficiency. This is the dilemma that American Christianity wrestles with today, to claim that we follow Jesus and yet abide by greed, selfishness, and control. And see to the formation of self that operates by human standards and expectations, bound by a religious distortion of the image of self in chasing after what we want, but not who we are. So where do we go from here, friends? I suppose the only logical question we can pose is, can we start again? Can we reframe this thing? So be liberated by the picture reality of communion, community, and mutuality, and servanthood with one another. When we enter into the Jesus space, the joining space, where we gather to flourish and life together to work in collaboration, moving away from the things that drain us, seeking mutual ownership, a new kind of shared strength that dislodges us from death and frees us to flow towards life. There is a name for this. We call it resurrection. The divine way of liberating us, of reforming us. It is the pathway to start again, to reclaim the entire thing as Jesus did. It offers all kinds of new possibilities. But how ought we to be with each other moving forward? How might this inform our formation of self in the light of the divine vision for humanity? And this become the new revelation theology that shall guide us into the next season of being human with one another. To my dearly beloved, my siblings in Christ, Mr. Lionel, please, and Mama, regardless of the coming political outcome, no matter what the economy may say, despite the social injustices of our world, we must still choose communion, mutuality, and humility with each other. So can we start again? Can we reclaim our imagination itself? Can we be liberated? The answer is yes, it is possible, especially when we gather around the means of grace, the good news of Jesus, the table, the sacrament of the altar, as Luther said. Remembering our baptism, remembering the single life that was ransomed for many, and remembering that resurrection is already alive in us. So let's start again. Word of God and Word of Life, we all take together. Thank you.